Why do so many of the world's most notorious aviation accidents feature a loss of control element? And what are we doing about it? Now, instead of having me droning on about this, I will let my colleague and friend Ben do this one, since he's actually instructing Boeing 737 pilots about this right now. So, Ben, come in.
Hey.
It's cool. I'm just going to give him the mic and he will continue on from here.
All yours.
No pressure. Ah, this is new. Now, Petter recently made a video about the high number of tragic accidents and incidents that we've seen over the past few weeks and months, and looked at whether or not there's a pattern or a trend that we should be worried about. In that video, Petter showed that while we obviously need to get to the bottom of each one of these accidents to make sure that they can't happen again, there's actually little to suggest that there's a connection between them. There are lessons, of course, but this is definitely not a crisis. Having said that, over the years, the aviation industry has studied patterns and common threads in aircraft accidents, and one of them is the loss of control of an aircraft. Unfortunately, several well-known accidents directly involved such a loss of control. Two of which happened not too long ago. In 2009, Colgan Air Flight 3407, which Petter covered on the Mentor Pilot channel, was a Bombardier Q400 flying to Buffalo in New York. That crew entered icing conditions during their approach into Buffalo, which the crew weren't prepared for. Now, there are more factors involved in that accident, which Petter goes into more detail on, but the end result was the aircraft stalling and the flight crew being unable to recover in time, resulting in the loss of all 49 people on board, plus another one on the ground. Later that same year, Air France 447 stalled during the cruise phase of flight, and unfortunately all 228 passengers perished when their Airbus A330 crashed into the Atlantic Ocean. Then more recently, in August last summer, Voipass Flight 2283, an ATR 72 operated domestically in Brazil, was lost after entering a flat spin and hitting the ground, with the loss of all 62 people on board. Now, the investigation is still ongoing, but icing conditions appear to have played a key role here. Now, aviation employs a wide variety of systems and procedures designed to prevent a loss of control in flight, or LOC-E, as it's known in the industry, from occurring. And as a result, these events are incredibly rare, but they still account for about one quarter of all fatalities in scheduled commercial air transport. So, with all the sophistication of today's airliners, how can such loss of control events still be possible? Well, to understand this, let's start by looking at what we classify as abnormal when it comes to the flight envelope. Historically, this classification was defined by very specific parameters. And these included unintentionally exceeding any one of the following: a pitch attitude of more than 25 degrees nose up, or 10 degrees nose down, an angle of bank of more than 45 degrees left or right, or less than these parameters, but flying at an airspeed inappropriate for the conditions. Now, if our aircraft exceeded any one of these parameters, it would be classified as an aircraft upset. However, in more recent years, the internationally agreed definition of an aircraft upset has changed, and it's now defined as any time an aeroplane is diverting from the intended aeroplane state. So that begs the question, how does that happen? How can an aircraft that is fully controllable find itself deviating from the intended state? Well, accident investigators have identified four main root causes for loss of control in real-world accidents and incidents, and these include adverse weather, aircraft system faults, pilot error, or more typically, some combination of the above, since aircraft accidents are nearly always caused by a mixture of different factors. So let's take a brief look at each one of these causes, and we'll start with weather. Airframe icing falls under this category, and any ice formation on an aircraft has the potential to affect its aerodynamic properties, and therefore how it handles. Ice buildup can cause not only a loss of lift being generated by our wings, but also extra drag, and even engine malfunctions in extreme cases. So it starts to become clear how ice can lead to a loss of control in flight event. With that said, airliners are fully equipped and certified to fly in icing conditions, but we do try to avoid areas of moderate to severe icing, just like we try to avoid any other area that could be hazardous to aviation. One of the systems we have on board to help detect hazardous weather is a highly sophisticated weather radar. This enables us to identify and avoid weather such as cumulonimbus or thunderstorm clouds and the turbulence that comes with them. No pilot would deliberately take their aircraft into a thunderstorm, as the turbulence can be lethal. But there are other weather-related events that are harder to detect and avoid, such as clear air turbulence. And when two differing air masses collide, turbulence can result, similar to how the flow of two rivers would mix unexpectedly, except that when we fly, the mixing air doesn't give us the same visual clues. Careful planning, studying pre-flight weather forecasts, and in-flight monitoring of air temperatures and wind speeds can help us avoid these areas of turbulence sometimes. Unfortunately though, avoiding clear air turbulence entirely just isn't really possible, as it's invisible to not only us, but also to our weather radar, as well as to the other onboard systems. And we saw its effects last year with Singapore Airlines Flight 321, which you've also covered on this channel. We are getting better at predicting this kind of turbulence though, as Petter explained in that video. But to be safe, you should always keep your seatbelt fastened when you're sitting down in the cabin, just as we do when we're flying up front. Another weather phenomena that has the potential to cause a loss of control event are mountain waves. These are created by the movement of air masses over high terrain, sometimes as high as 15,000 feet above the highest peaks, and which create effects very similar to clear air turbulence. Lower down, closer to the ground, we have another potentially lethal weather phenomena known as wind shear. This is a sudden and really dramatic change in low-level wind speed or direction, and can be a real threat to aircraft during takeoff or landing. But again, we do have systems on board the aircraft that constantly monitor low-level conditions and immediately warn us if wind shear conditions exist. And all crew are trained in the wind shear escape maneuver, which enables us to react quickly and fly safely away from the threat. Microbursts are really similar, but less frequent, but very, very dangerous. These are very strong downdrafts associated with powerful thunderstorms and are proven to be extremely dangerous when you're low to the ground and flying relatively slowly. But again, our weather radar can help us detect and avoid areas where microbursts may occur. And airports that are susceptible to such phenomena have their own advanced monitoring systems, which enhance the situation awareness of air traffic controllers and flight crews alike. Now, there's also another kind of turbulence which isn't weather related at all. This is known as wake turbulence, and it can be quite common and potentially very dangerous. This phenomenon is a byproduct of lift and occurs when the high pressure air below the wings spills over onto the low pressure area above. This creates a swirling motion of air known as a vortex, and these act like a pair of circular funnels of fast moving air trailing off each wingtip. Now, the size and strength of these vortices are directly related to the weight of the aircraft. The larger and heavier the aircraft, the more lift it needs to generate, and the stronger the vortices, and the greater the danger to the aircraft flying behind and below. To prevent this, we have strict rules in place that prevent aircraft from flying too close together, depending on their size. Then, beyond turbulence and other weather issues, the other root cause of loss of control events are technical faults and pilot error. But before that, there's this.
Psst, you. Yeah, you. I hope you're enjoying this video so far, because putting together this script wasn't exactly smooth sailing. My team and I kept running into geo-blocked content. You know, when you find an awesome link that should contain all you need, and then you click on it and boom, not available in your country. This is something that especially my scriptwriter Spiros, who is based in Athens, knows all too well. But thankfully, he is now using today's sponsor, NordVPN, which is a real lifesaver for things like this. You see, not only will Nord keep your connection secure, it will also let you access content from all over the world at a click of a button, whether that's industry reports, exclusive videos, or maybe your favorite TV show. Now, I personally also use Nord for its excellent cybersecurity features that blocks malware, trackers, and ads, and it also protects my privacy, especially when using public Wi-Fis at hotels, airports, and restaurants. I also use it to find better deals on rental cars, hotels, and flights, since pricing might differ depending on from where you are booking. Just make sure you clear your cache after switching locations, otherwise it won't work. So if you want to try out Nord for yourself, it's super affordable, and even more so if you use my QR code or the link in the description here below, which is nordvpn.com/mentornow. That will give you 4 extra months for free when you sign up for the 2-year deal, and it's completely risk-free since Nord always gives you a 30-day money-back guarantee. Thank you, Nord. Now, back to the video.
Now, let's talk about how technical issues with the aircraft can cause a loss of control event. Aircraft instruments can play a big role here, and there are several reasons why an aircraft instrument can give false or misleading information. It could be anything from a straightforward instrument failure to erroneous input data, and these can be really tough to diagnose. Now, there are plenty of safeguards around these systems. For example, if there's any incorrect data going into an autoflight system, that may cause the autopilot to disengage. But this is something that the pilots need to react to quickly, just like they need to recognize and react to any discrepancy between the flight instruments. Problems like unreliable airspeed can very quickly become loss of control events if not dealt with properly. And beyond the instruments and autoflight systems, any problems with the flight controls can quickly result in the crew losing control of their aircraft. So that's technical faults. Now we come to pilot error. And sadly, too many accidents or incidents have been incorrectly or partially incorrectly attributed to pilot error. And simply blaming the pilots has become an easy way of explaining the unexplainable. But as with most things, there's often a lot more to it. Once pilots find themselves in a loss of control situation, they will have some time to recover the aircraft. But if they don't promptly recognize the situation and apply the correct recovery techniques, the situation will deteriorate to the point where recovery will become impossible. Now, these situations can develop incredibly quickly. And when you factor in elements such as high G-forces and the inevitable startle factor, it can become a real challenge to recognize and process what the aircraft is doing. And without this recognition, it will be impossible to effect a safe recovery. So now we understand what an aircraft upset looks like and why they happen. But how has the industry reacted to this threat? Well, the answer is something that we call UPRT. And it's a type of training that all new commercial pilots have to undergo and will be regularly trained on in their recurrent training. So what does this mean and why is it so important for the aviation industry? Well, UPRT stands for Upset Prevention and Recovery Training. So to explore how this works, let's look more closely at each element of UPRT in turn and try to understand how it can stop pilots from losing control of perfectly flyable aircraft. Well, the reality is that commercial pilots spend their careers within a relatively small flight envelope. For example, spinning exercises were taken out of the private pilot's license syllabus back in 1982. And to try to further understand just how small this flight envelope is, let's look at a visual representation. In this image, the red sector represents the aircraft's entire flight envelope, and any pilot could suddenly and unexpectedly find themselves anywhere within this envelope. The small green sector represents the normal flight envelope, the area that pilots usually spend their entire careers operating within. And the orange area, well, that goes beyond and represents the area where pilots are typically trained to recover from. Anytime a commercial aircraft moves from the green sector to the orange sector, the aircraft is considered to be in an upset condition. Now, although alarming, this shouldn't result in a loss of control, as pilots have been trained to recover from the orange sector to get back into the safety of the green. However, as you can see here, both the green and the orange sectors represent a very small segment of the flight envelope. And as soon as an aircraft enters the red zone, the pilots can rapidly find themselves in a position that's potentially beyond anything they've been trained for. But it's not just the prevention of entering into this red zone that's troubling the world's airlines. There's also a real concern that some of the pilots might not be able to move from the red zone back into the safety of the green. And here we have to talk about prevention, because from a pilot's very first lesson, we're taught the art of staying within the green box, and later how to recognize and recover the aircraft if they ever venture into the orange. And up until 1982 in the UK or 1949 in the USA, all pilots had to demonstrate their ability to recover an aircraft when it left the orange zone and ended up somewhere in the massive red zone. To do this, the aircraft was deliberately flown into a stall, and once the wings had stalled, the instructor would apply full rudder, which would result in the aircraft rapidly entering a spin. Now that's red zone territory. The student and instructor were now in an aircraft that was potentially out of control. And without the correct recovery procedure, the aircraft would continue to fall from the sky until it impacted the earth below. This kind of training allowed new pilots to not only recognize what was happening, but to also experience it, and then to practice applying the correct recovery procedures. Of course, modern simulators are incredible feats of engineering, and they play a vital role in pilot training. But no simulator can ever repeat the G-forces or disorientation that pilots are exposed to in a real-life upset event. Not only that, but designing commercial aircraft so that they are recoverable from something like a fully developed spin just isn't something that they can be tested for during development. So for these reasons, the authorities decided that prevention was key. If pilots could prevent their aircraft from entering the red zone, then the likelihood of a loss of control event was dramatically reduced. But is this enough? Surely, if a pilot can recognize an impending loss of control and prevent it, then that should be sufficient. Well, on paper, yes. But there's far more to the story than that. And this is where we get to the recovery. The recovery phase of UPRT focuses on providing pilots with the knowledge and the skills necessary to apply the appropriate inputs, which will enable the aircraft to return back into the green without overstressing the airframe. So now we've taught our pilots how to recognize the potential dangers that face them. They've also witnessed and experienced the approach to stall warnings, the pre-stall buffet, the lack of effectiveness of the flying controls, the low airspeed, and the numerous computer warnings built into modern aircraft that help prevent the aircraft from stalling. All of these are an effective way of recognizing and recovering the aircraft before it enters into the orange zone, and definitely before it enters the red. And during initial and recurrent training, pilots are trained and tested on their abilities to recognize and recover from these very scenarios. All of this is vital, and it will prevent the vast majority of loss of control incidents and accidents. Hopefully, a pilot will go through their entire career without ever leaving the green, let alone the orange sectors. And of course, this is what we, the pilots, as well as the traveling public, want: a nice, easy, safe flight. However, if our aircraft suddenly and without warning goes from the green to the red, we definitely don't want this real-life event to be the very first time that we've experienced it. And this is where the good news starts, because the aviation industry is now doing everything it can to train pilots in the art of recovery from loss of control events. Starting in 2011, and as a result of the tragedies like Colgan Air and Air France 447, new legislation requires newly qualified pilots to complete specific UPRT training. And since then, advanced UPRT has become a prerequisite for the Airline Pilot Standards Multi-Crew Cooperation Course, or APS-MCC. The exact nature and duration of these courses can vary from place to place, but in EASA states, the advanced UPRT course includes a minimum of 5 hours of theoretical and 3 hours of practical instruction. UPRT also needs to be part of recurrent training for line pilots, and there's a requirement for airlines to retrospectively train pilots who qualified before the new regulations came into place. Each airline is now required to demonstrate that they have implemented an initial and renewable UPRT program. But again, these rules can vary in different parts of the world. Finally, we have to say how important modern day simulators are when it comes to translating this real world training into cockpits of airliners. And as I already said, they do have their limits. You can't completely replicate the startle factor of an upset or the G-forces that come with it, even in the very best simulators. But what they can do is show pilots what the various upsets look like and enable them to practice the correct recovery techniques so that they become instinctive. That's why the sophistication of the latest simulator technology is playing a vital part to the recognition and recovery techniques that all pilots need to learn to ensure that the lessons learned from accidents of the past help protect us all in the future. But what do you think? Are we doing enough, or should there be an even bigger focus on UPRT? Let us know in the comments below.
Thanks for that, Ben. That was great, wasn't it? I would love to hear what you guys think about this slightly new format. Let us know if you have any suggestions that, you know, Ben maybe could improve on something, or something that you want him to explain more about, because you're going to see much more of him going forward. Now, if you want to see another video, which I think that you really like, then check this one out. And if you want to support my team and I, then consider joining my awesome Patreon crew. Just go to patreon.com/join/mentorpilot. It really, really helps what we do. Have an absolutely fantastic day wherever you are, and we will see you next time. Bye-bye.